His classmates called him El Guajiro, the Hick. And he liked nothing more than to revisit the Cuba of his childhood. Fidel Castro came of age at Las Manacas, a sprawling sugar plantation in Cuba's remote northeast. His father, Angel, a former Spanish soldier, had come to Cuba at the turn of the century to fight in the Spanish-American War and made his fortune growing sugarcane for the U.S.-owned United Fruit Company, the dominant economic and social force in the region at the time.
There is definitely a lot of history encoded in that childhood of Fidel Castro's. He was the outsider. He was born illegitimately. His father had been married to a school teacher. Then he took up with a family maid who was Fidel's mother. And they were only married when the children were sent to Catholic schools. Fidel very seldom spoke about this, never directly.
Fidel's mother, Lina Ruiz, was a poor but ambitious country girl. Once described
of hers, truly meant what he said.
In October 1941, at age 15, Fidel went to Havana to attend El Colegio de Belén, Cuba's best and most exclusive school. His rural upbringing clashed with that of his schoolmates, raised in the cultured and literate homes of Cuba's upper class. His reckless behavior earned him a nickname, El Loco, the crazy one.
Fidel Castro always wanted to win at everything. Once he made a bet that he would crash against the back wall of one of the school's long corridors. So for $5, he got on his bike and crashed into the wall. He lost consciousness and spent several days in the infirmary recovering.
It was at Belén, under the guidance of Spanish Jesuit priests, that the young Castro began to form his worldview.
The Jesuits Fidel encountered in Havana in the 1940s came out of the experience of the Spanish Civil War. From the nationalist faction, the faction close to fascism. And they were steeped in the idea of the superiority of the Hispanic Catholic world over the materialistic, corrupt Anglo-Saxon world.
Fidel impressed his teachers with his athletic abilities, photographic memory, and enormous tenacity. They singled him out as someone who would, no doubt, fill the book of his life with brilliant pages. When he entered the University of Havana in 1945, he set out to fulfill that promise.
One night we were studying, and we decided to take a break and went to have a cafe con leche at a nearby cafe. And we started talking about the future. And I said, I'd like to travel and have a lot of friends, which was the truth. And another guy said, I want to be a poet. Another wanted to be a lawyer. Then I turned to Fidel and said, Guajiro, what do you want? And he said, I want glory and fame.
Thank you. The University of Havana had been a hotbed of political activity since the 1930s, when students led a revolt against dictator Gerardo Machado.
1930s is a violent period in Cuban political history. Social and political struggles continue through a good part of that decade, and the idea was that if you were to be politically effective, at some point you needed to be ready to wield a gun. When Fidel arrived at the university, you needed guns as well. Now, not for noble revolutionary goals, but just to protect yourself and your friends. And there are gangs.
Fidel's generation had a terrible sense of frustration. Cuba was supposed to be one of the three wealthiest countries in the hemisphere with the United States and Argentina, and yet they couldn't put themselves together politically. It was one tragedy after the other. The War of 1898, the Americans' intervention, the Platt Amendment, which gave the United States virtually power over anything in Cuba. They saw leader after leader either be corrupt, killed, replaced by the United States, fail, fail, fail.
While he was a student at the University of Havana, Fidel came under the influence of nationalist Cuban professors, began to study Cuban history very seriously. He concluded that Cuba had not been in control of its own history, and he blamed the United States.
Fidel jumped into the fray. He helped organize strikes and demonstrations, ran for student president, joined a gang. He was a combination of genius and juvenile delinquent, one fellow student recalled. He would show signs of brilliance and then behave like a hoodlum. He was implicated in the fatal shooting of a rival student leader, but charges were never filed. He was identified by a witness in connection with the murder of a university police sergeant, but the witness recanted his testimony. Mirta Diaz Balart was 19 years old when she fell in love with Fidel Castro. She was a philosophy student at the University of Havana and a member of a prominent Cuban family.
I introduced them and told her, you know, he's crazy. He's paranoid and a psychopath who would just as soon throw you off the 10th floor as buy you a mink coat. And she said, I know, but I am in love. And I replied, well then, marry him. She was the one who was in love, not I.
They were married on October 12, 1948, and went on an extended honeymoon to New York. For the first time, I tried T-bone steak, smoked salmon, and other things that a young man with a big appetite enjoyed a lot, Fidel later recalled. With his father's money, he bought a white Lincoln Continental, took an apartment in the Bronx, and tried to teach himself English by learning 200 words a day. Back from their honeymoon, Fidel and Mirta settled in Havana, where he set up a small law practice. Mirta gave birth to a son, Fidel Castro Diaz Balart, Fidelito. But Castro was seldom home, and there was never enough money.
Castro came in one morning, and he didn't realize until later that day that all his furniture in the living room, including Fidelito's playpen, all is gone. Because they've been repossessed, he didn't pay the bills. This is a man who doesn't have a sense of feeling, empathy, for the things that ordinary human beings need to live their lives more or less normally.
Politics was Fidel's all-consuming passion. As Cubans looked forward to free elections in 1952, the fourth to be held since a new constitution went into effect in 1940, the young lawyer seized the moment. He campaigned for a congressional seat as a member of the Ortodoxo Party, calling for responsible government and an end to corruption. As election day approached, Fidel Castro had a real chance for victory. Then, on March 10th, General Fulgencio Batista led a military coup d'etat, shattering Cuban democracy and Fidel's political aspirations.
El General Batista, ante los micrófonos de todas las emisoras del país.
Arriba,
silencio.
Silencio.
Hablo al pueblo de Cuba desde la ciudad militar esta vez, en donde he tenido que regresar forzado por la...
Batista da un golpe.
Batista's coup opens a Pandora's box. It creates the perfect conditions for the rise of a revolutionary hero. Institutions no longer matter. What matters is audacity, the individual that is capable of violent actions. There is a story Fidel tells. He's on the steps of the university, without money, his marriage on the rocks, no work, and he doesn't know what to do. And it is a wonderful moment. That night, when he says, I have to deliver a blow, I have to make a revolution. And that's when he decides to attack the Moncada barracks.
On July 26, 1953, Fidel Castro, hoping to incite a rebellion, led 129 men and two women in a daring assault against the Moncada army barracks in Santiago de Cuba. Even if it fails, Fidel had said, it would be heroic and have symbolic value. It was a massacre. 8 attackers were killed, 12 wounded. More than 60 were taken prisoner, tortured, and then executed. Fidel Castro was captured 7 days later, his life spared through the intervention of Santiago's Catholic Archbishop. In the days following the assault, Fulgencio Batista called for 10 men to be killed for every one of his soldiers dead at Moncada. Published photographs of the mutilated bodies of Cuba's youth repulsed the nation and made a hero of the man who had led the daring assault.
The repression by the Batista forces was so harsh. There were so many young men, mostly young men, who were killed and who were savagely repressed, that it was a wake-up call for the Cuban people.
At his trial, Fidel Castro held the attention of all Cuba. Arguing in his own defense, the young lawyer spoke the words that would become legend. "Condemn me," he said. "It does not matter. History will absolve me." Fidel and his younger brother Raul were sentenced to 15 years and sent to the Isle of Pines prison. November 7th, 1953. Dear Nati, if you have suffered because of me, remember that I would gladly give my life for your honor and your happiness. Fidel Castro had fallen in love with Natalia Revuelta, the beautiful wife of a prominent Cuban doctor.
The relationship between my mother and Fidel began in the early 1950s. They met in the days before Moncada. And then he's sent to jail. From prison, there began an exchange of correspondence that in time became deeper, more passionate.
Fidel asked for cigars, his favorite foods. Mostly, he asked for books. He read the works of Cuba's patriot, José Martí, Dostoevsky, Rousseau, Marx, and Lenin. "What a terrific school this prison is," he wrote Nati. "Here I can shape my view of the world and perfect the meaning of my life." From his prison cell, Castro reworked his defense speech, "History Will Absolve Me," which his wife Mirta smuggled out of prison a few pages at a time. It called for the violent 65-foot yacht approached the coast of southeast Cuba. Aboard the Granma were Fidel Castro and 81 expeditionaries returning from Mexico to wage war against Batista. But the Granma had been spotted. And by the time Castro's men landed, Batista's army was waiting. Fidel Castro was reported dead. But he had taken cover in a sugarcane field. 3 days later, unharmed, he began walking towards the mountains.
Batista makes a huge strategic blunder. You push landings back to the sea, but Batista pushes Castro toward the Sierra Maestra. And he says, and this is verbatim, "No one survives in the Sierra Maestra."
Eighteen men vanished into the forbidding Sierra Maestra mountain range, including Fidel, Raul, and an Argentinian doctor named Ernesto Guevara, known as Che. 3 months later, the rebels reappeared on the front page of the New York Times. In a series of three articles, Herbert Matthews, a seasoned war correspondent, launched the legend of Fidel Castro. Matthews wrote, "Here is quite a man, a powerful six-footer, olive-skinned with a scraggly beard. He has strong ideas of liberty, democracy, and social justice."
This is the Sierra Maestra, 200 miles of jungle.
Following in Matthew's footsteps, a CBS documentary crew made its own pilgrimage.
These are the jungle fighters, the rebels of Sierra Maestra. This is their story.
I am going to tell you what happened. Batista does not want to admit that he is incapable of defeating us. He hopes to obtain by liar that which he cannot get by force of arms. Sometimes he said that I am dead. Another time, he says that there is nobody in Sierra Maestra. But he won't let anyone to come here to Sierra Maestra. And when the soldiers are killed in battle, he says that they were died in accident. Have been a great deal of accidents here in Sierra Maestra last month.
Fidel played up his war for an American television audience. But a much larger war was being waged in Cuba's cities. In Havana, the Student Revolutionary Directorate stormed the presidential palace in March 1957 in a desperate attempt to assassinate Batista. Their leader, José Antonio Echeverría, was gunned down. In Santiago, Cuba's second largest city, the 26th of July movement underground waged a fierce struggle and bore the brunt of the repression. Their leader, Frank Pais, was ambushed in July. Cubans from all walks of life, rich and poor, businessmen and workers, angry students and grieving mothers, filled the streets of Santiago in a somber demonstration.
Batista does a number of things that gradually expand the revolutionary coalition until it includes almost everyone. He's corrupt. He's very repressive. You reach a point in the late 1950s where virtually everyone is opposed to the regime.
High up in the mountains of the Sierra Maestra, Fidel Castro was fast becoming the symbol of resistance against Batista. It was there, among the peasants, that the romance of Castro's guerrilla war was born. Years later, Celia Sanchez, Fidel's friend and confidant, wistfully recalled, "Those were the best times. We'll never be so happy again. Never." Members of the urban underground and opposition party leaders climbed the mountains to meet with Fidel and work out the details of a future coalition government.
The manifesto of the Sierra Maestra called for a democratic republic, a return to the constitution of 1940, free elections. I don't think he signed it intending to honor it.
Fidel realizes that he has his army and his people, who have nothing to do with the politicians among whom he once belonged. He discovers in those sallow, ill-humored, illiterate peasants the true meaning of a revolution, which is to subvert society, to take the people from the bottom, everyone, and create something new. That old idea of Lenin, that you must destroy the state, he understands it. And now he knows who he can destroy it with.
The handful of guerrillas who had survived the disaster of the Granma grew into a rebel army. Fidel commanded with an iron hand.
People began to notice that Fidel demanded obedience, that he was not very likely to consult, that he wanted to take decisions on his own and wanted others simply to comply.
I remember Fidel once scolded a guerrilla fighter. He was so brutal, so obscene, so humiluating. I would stay up in my hammock thinking, what will happen in the future? Then I would see Camilo, Che, obey Fidel and admire him so. And I would ask myself, am I the only one who doubts?
In the summer of 1958, Batista decided once and for all to get rid of Fidel Castro, deploying 10,000 soldiers against 300 rebels. Within 30 days, they had encircled Fidel's forces, but they were now deep in rebel territory and vulnerable to attack. Fidel's strategy was simple. Like ping pong, he said, you hit them where they least expect it. Earlier that spring, the United States, embarrassed by Batista's brutality, had suspended military assistance to his regime.
It created the perception that, one, the Cuban army could no longer effectively fight the guerrilla movement up in the hills, And secondly, from a political perspective, it sent the signal that the United States no longer supported Batista.
But Castro, who since his days at the university had resented the American presence in Cuba, found the gesture to be meaningless. Once this struggle is finished, I'll begin the real struggle of my life, he wrote Celia in June of 1958. The fight I will wage against the United States. I believe that is my true destiny. In August, rebel forces left the mountains and fanned across Cuba. Fidel ordered Camilo Cienfuegos and Che Guevara to move west. Uber Matos took the surrender of Santiago de Cuba. Che Guevara blew up an armored train in Santa Clara and took the city. Batista's demoralized.
Renounce to any position. I would gladly renounce to any position because sincerely, I don't ambition power, money, nothing, only to serve my country.
In keeping with the manifesto of the Sierra Maestra, an interim government that included all opposition groups assumed power. Elections were scheduled to take place in 18 months. But real power resided with Fidel, at his old headquarters in the Sierra, at Celia Sanchez's apartment in El Vedado, at a beach house in Cojima, where all major decisions were made. One of the first acts of the revolutionary government was retribution. In less than 3 months, more than 500 Batistianos were publicly tried and executed. When the international press called it a bloodbath, Castro, incensed, made his case on television.
The purpose of today's gathering is to show the whole world that all Cubans are united in the rebel victory and that all of them support the execution.
When the young people would appear murdered in the streets with the tops of their heads, when the yards of the barracks would be full of cadavers, when our women were violated, when the children were murdered, when the police hordes would go into the embassy to assassinate our people, no one made a campaign against Cuba.
An ominous new chant, Paradón, to the wall, was heard throughout Cuba. Fidel Castro's role as Cuba's leader became official on February 16th, the day he was appointed prime minister.
New York's Pennsylvania Station rarely has seen anything like it. Only the magnetism of a Castro could produce it, for this is the spontaneous...
Prime Minister Fidel Castro arrived in New York in April 1959, part of a 15-day goodwill tour. He was young and idealistic, his appeal undiminished by the recent accusations of a bloodbath.
Customers are eager to see him, to touch him.
Fidel, will you say just a few words to New Yorkers who have seen you for the first time?
Well, I'm very glad to be here again because I fulfilled my promise of coming after the victorious revolution.
He's a movie star, the James Dean of international politics. He's viewed as a savior, leading a revolution to improve people's lives and to show that the people of Latin America can be in control of their own destiny.
Now, Dr. Castro,
however,
you ready?
There was some concern that he might be a communist. And so on Meet the Press,
Castro,
he is asked,
Senator Smathers of Florida
says that you have many communists in your government. Is that so?
I know. Because Senator Smasser said it ought to be true. I don't think that.
And then he's asked, well, what about your brother?
An American magazine published here this week says that your brother is a communist and his wife also.
And how,
do you believe
how
that?
How U.S. is going to know that better than myself, that is my brother and my sister-in-law. I can't tell that they are not communists.
He denied, and he knew, that this was not true. He denied the role that communists in his inner circle had played.
In Washington, U.S. officials stood ready to offer Castro economic aid.
Did you ask for any economic assistance?
Not. What happened is that here you in the United States are accustomed to see government coming for money. Not. I came for good relations, for good understanding, for good economical relations.
Vice President Richard Nixon urged the Cuban Prime Minister to hold elections as soon as possible. The people do not want elections, Castro informed him. In the past, they produced bad government.
Nixon's conclusion was that he's probably not a communist, but he is going to be, the phrase was roughly, a man to be reckoned with in this hemisphere. And we have to be very careful.
Cuba's revolutionary transformation began on May 17, 1959, with the proclamation of the Agrarian Reform Law. Las Manacas, the Castro family farm, was the first landholding to be confiscated. Fidel's mother, Lina, was furious and would never forgive her son. ...200,000 peasants received title to land they had once worked. On July 26th, the anniversary of Moncada, they descended on Havana to celebrate.
When I first arrived in Havana from the countryside in 1941, everyone treated me with scorn. To see now how the rich, the middle classes, welcomed the peasants to Havana in 1959 and put them up in their own homes was beautiful. As if everyone realized that there had to be an end to injustice.
As Castro surveyed the crowd of 1 million gathered on that day, he compared Cuba's new government to ancient Athens. Except better, because Cuba's revolutionary government was not for the privileged classes or the oligarchy. This, he said, is true democracy.
As early as March, I found some pro-Marxist propaganda in a magazine distributed to the rebel army. 1, 2, 3 articles. And we saw Guevara and Raul meeting with Communist Party leaders. So observing all that, I began to think there's a second plan being put in place here.
Comandante Uber Matos had noted that the Cuban communists were an unexpected and influential new force in the revolution. Fidel, you are destroying your own work, Matos wrote, resigning his command. Fidel called the rebel comandante disloyal, ungrateful, a traitor, and had him arrested.
This is a critical moment, a defining moment in which the radicals say, this is the direction we're going, and even people who fought with us cannot say no.
Matos's fate seemed a foregone conclusion.
Raúl Castro pedía el fusilamiento.
Raúl Castro wanted him executed.
Que también lo pedía, se pasó.
Che Guevara agreed, then changed his mind.
Yo me limité a decirle a
Fidel. I said, Fidel, didn't you say that this revolution wouldn't be like Saturn, who devoured his own children? And Fidel responded, no, we're not going to execute him. We don't want to create a martyr.
Matos was sentenced to 20 years in prison. Many moderates in Castro's government resigned in protest or were dismissed. Some left for the United States. Others joined an opposition movement beginning to take shape in Cuba. By the first anniversary of the revolution, Fidel Castro had the reins of power firmly in hand. His brother Raúl was Minister of Defense. His friend Che Guevara headed the central bank. An obscure lawyer, Osvaldo Dorticós, was president. For most Cubans, it had been a good year. The price of public services dropped. New public works projects were begun. Rents were slashed in half. And students would soon be sent into the mountains to teach peasants to read and write.
My generation fell in love with that revolution. Popular education, access to health, social justice. And he was so appealing politically, had such an interesting way of expressing ideas.
What I found so fascinating was there was Fidel up here on the podium, making all these strange gestures, waving his arms. There, out there, are 200,000 plus Cubans for 7-8 hours while Fidel is up here directing them and enchanting them, weaving a spell over them.
Perhaps his most important accomplishment was understanding the Cuban people where they were and challenging them to do great things. And the Cuban people, at that time, a majority of them responded. They turned their goodwill, their faith, and their judgment over to Fidel Castro. And that was a huge political capital, a political capital that allowed him to, in fact, centralize power.
Soviet Deputy Premier Anastas Mikoyan arrived in Havana on February 3, 1960, to inaugurate a technological and cultural exhibit. For 3 days, he was feted in tropical splendor. For the Soviets, it was a foray into a world filled with opportunity. For Americans, it was the beginning of a Cold War nightmare.
Our fear was twofold. Number one, that the Soviets might somehow use Cuba in such a way as to threaten U.S. security. Number two, that Castro's revolution would strengthen the Soviet hand in Latin America.
Cuba, 90 miles away from Florida, is an aircraft carrier for the Soviets. It is something that they'd never had before. It is a place from which they can project power. That island of Cuba was the offshore base that the Soviet Union had always wanted to have next to the United States.
Crisis in Cuba. Anti-Castro leaflets are scattered over the city by a plane based in the United States and reportedly flown by Castro's former Air Force chief. The United States gets much of the blame for the rising...
For some time now, relations between the United States and Cuba had deteriorated. As Castro fanned the flames of Cuban nationalism, playing up a history of American domination.
The American government would send in its ambassador, Philip Bonsall, to say, look, we understand. American enterprises are overrepresented here. The drug companies, the oil companies, the cement companies, Bell Telephone. Let's talk about this. Instead of talking, Fidel Castro would go out and make a 4 or 5 hour speech condemning American imperialism and bringing 1 million people into the square and sending them off really rabid with anti-American fervor.
At some point in February, March of 1959, Fidel Castro had come to the decision that there could not be a revolution in Cuba, that he could not build the Cuba that he wanted unless he extirpated the United States from Cuba. And at that point, there was very little the U.S. government could do to shake that conviction.
At the end of Mikoyan's visit, Castro signed an agreement with the Soviet Union that would seal the fate of Cuba-U.S. relations. The Soviets would provide oil in exchange for Cuban sugar.
This was a time when most Latin American countries had no relationship whatsoever with the Soviet Union, and to forge such a relationship was seen by Washington as deserting the United States in the Cold War.
Our interpretation was that Castro had made his decision. He was going to side with the Soviet Union, and therefore we lost interest in negotiations. And in March of 1960, President Eisenhower signed the finding which authorized the CIA to begin actions to get rid of the Castro regime.
In June, the first major shipment of Soviet crude oil arrived. Castro requested that American oil companies in Cuba refine 1 million barrels of the Soviet crude. They refused. On June 29th, the Cuban government nationalized the oil companies. 4 days later, the U.S. government threatened to cut back on Cuban sugar imports. Castro authorized the expropriation of all U.S. property.
¿Cuál era la alternativa del gobierno revolucionario? Traicionar al pueblo. Y no lo serías con toda seguridad si en vez de ser nosotros leales a nuestro pueblo, hubiésemos sido leales a los grandes monopolios norteamericanos que explotaban la economía de nuestro país.
That September, Castro lashed out at the U.S. before the United Nations and flaunted his new friendship with Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev. The following month, the Eisenhower administration imposed a trade embargo against Cuba.
There is a limit to what the United States and self-respect can endure. That limit has now been reached.
On January 3rd, 1961, the United States broke relations with Cuba.
And my conviction that in the not too distant future, it will be possible for the historic friendship between us once again to find reflection.
The departure of Cubans to the United States, which began shortly after the revolution, turned into an exodus.
Batista people were the first to arrive here. Then political figures started arriving, and finally the people whose property were being threatened or confiscated.
Cuban exiles organized themselves into an anti-Castro movement in close contact with the opposition within Cuba.
The overwhelming majority of the people who opposed Castro in 1959, 1960, 1961 had opposed Batista. And so they felt doubly aggrieved. They had fought for a free democratic Cuba, and what they got was an emerging dictatorship, the elimination of most private property, and a menacing alliance with the Soviet Union.
An urban underground as powerful as the resistance against Batista now fought against Castro. Almost nightly, stores were bombed, sugarcane fields burned, factories sabotaged. And in the Escambray Mountains, in the center of Cuba, an insurrection had taken hold.
This was a largely, although not exclusively, peasant rebellion against the Cuban Revolution. The Cuban government in the 60s had mobilized four times between 50 and 100,000 milicianos to fight the rebels, to clean, to sweep the Escambray. The area became so dangerous for the government that they forcibly transferred thousands of peasant families out of the Escambray and relocated them in different parts of Cuba.
While the internal resistance fought the Cuban government, the CIA trained an army of exiles in Guatemala for an invasion of Cuba.
When I went and volunteered to be part of what ultimately turned out to be the Bay of Pigs invasion, I really thought that what we were going to do is go and train as guerrilla and go and train as underground individuals who would organize a massive uprising in Cuba. The concept of the invasion, I think, caught by surprise most of the people who were in the Bay of Pigs.
President John F. Kennedy launched the U.S.-backed invasion of Cuba on April 15, 1961, when he authorized B-26 planes to bomb Cuba's major airports, destroying most, but not all, of Castro's air force.
In the bombardment, there's a boy who is mortally wounded. And then he dips his finger in his own gut and writes with his blood on a door, Fidel. They take the fragment of that door to Fidel, who is deeply moved by this 16-year-old boy, who in his final moment of agony demonstrated his devotion with his blood.
The next day, Fidel Castro declared for the first time that his revolution was socialist. Immediately, he ordered the arrest of at least 20,000 Cubans, identified as opponents to the regime. For the next several hours, he anxiously awaited news. At dawn on April 17th, 1,400 Cuban exiles landed at Bay of Pigs on the Zapata Swamp, a site chosen at the last minute. Fidel personally took over the island's defense. Surrounded by the Cuban army, pounded from the ground and from the air, the exiles stood no chance. Seventy-two hours later, they surrendered.
The Bay of Pigs invasion so closely associates opposition to the revolution with the United States that Castro is able to wrap himself in the Cuban flag and declares any kind of opposition to the revolution as treason. And in most countries, treason is punishable by death.
That was a very dramatic turning point, a very decisive moment. Castro's credibility his strength in Cuba and throughout Latin America was enormously enhanced. His revolution at that moment was more consolidated than it had ever been before. He had done what no Latin American leader before him had ever done, and that was to defeat a really significant challenge mounted by the United States.
In November 1961, 7 months after the failure of the Bay of Pigs, President John Kennedy put his brother, Robert, in charge of a covert operation to get rid of Fidel Castro. Determined to avenge the president's humiliation on the beaches of Cuba, the Attorney General would stop at nothing. He engaged hundreds of CIA operatives in economic sabotage and infiltration missions. Old mafia contacts were dusted off to carry out harebrained assassination schemes. Arsenic in Castro's milkshake, poison in his cigars, thallium powder in his boots to make his beard fall out.
There's no question Fidel Castro thinks that the United States will try again after the failure of the Bay of Pigs. He sees the covert programs that are already underway, trying to assassinate him, trying to sabotage the economy. And he expects that the next time the United States will use its own troops, since the exile army was such a failure.
On October 14th, photographs by U-2 spy planes revealed that the Soviets were constructing ballistic missile sites in Cuba to house missiles that could reach the United States.
Fidel had not wanted the nuclear missiles. The Cuban request was for tanks, surface-to-air missiles, and for some, perhaps some Soviet soldiers. But once Fidel got them, he saw their value, and he loved the fact that they scared the gringos.
For the next 13 days, the world came closer to nuclear war than at any other time. The missiles intended to protect Cuba had only further endangered it, as the island now faced the imminent threat of a U.S. invasion. On October 27th, Castro dictated a letter to Ambassador Alexander Alexeyev, meant for Nikita Khrushchev.
According to Alexeyev's own account, Fidel dictated it 10 times. And at the very end, the letter was still red hot. Fidel was basically telling Khrushchev that if the Soviet Union had to use nuclear weapons to defend the socialist world, and if that meant that Cuba might be sacrificed, that's okay.
He had concluded that actually he had one of two choices. The choice was for Cuba to be destroyed and for Cuba to be destroyed, but for a reason. And you know, Khrushchev's reaction to this was, that guy's nuts. It sounds like he's telling me to blow up the world.
The Cuban government has ordered the dismantling of weapons in Cuba.
Yo estoy en mi periódico.
I was in my office preparing the Monday paper when I read on the teletype, Khrushchev orders missiles removed from Cuba. I called Fidel and asked him, what do I do with this cable? Because I could not imagine he didn't know it. And for 5 minutes, we went back and forth until he said, read it to me again. And that's how he found out.
Castro called Khrushchev a bastard, an SOB. Enraged, he shattered a huge mirror that hung in his office. He retreated to La Plata, his old guerrilla camp in the Sierra Maestra, to nurse his grievances. Friends remarked on his decline. He was gaunt, his brown eyes larger and darker than ever.
He sees that the Soviet Union will treat him in the same way the United States has treated Cuba historically. Great powers treat small powers as if they're inconsequential. And he never again trusts the Soviet Union fully.
Gentlemen of the brigade, I need not tell you how happy I am.
In December 1962, President Kennedy spoke to the surviving members of the Bay of Pigs.
What a profound impression your conduct during some of the most difficult days and months.
They had been ransomed for $53 million worth of food and medicine.
What a profound impression your conduct made. And I can assure you that it is the strongest wish of the people of this country that Cuba shall one day be free again.
But Kennedy had made a secret pledge. At the end of the missile crisis, he promised Khrushchev the United States would not invade Cuba.
Kennedy took one look at Cuba after the missile crisis and said, I'm out of here. I don't want to mess with these. Look, it almost got us blown up. Okay, you got to do a little something with the covert operations, and Bobby, my brother, will handle that. But no more messing around so that the Soviets come in here. I don't want this island on my chart anymore.
In the 1960s, Cuba was a mecca for a young generation committed to transforming the world.
It was an anti-imperialist era. The old colonialism was breaking down. And the movements for national liberation in Africa and in Asia, the war in Vietnam, Castro was very much a part of that landscape.
There was a very, very real sense that this was the revolutionary capital of the world. There were many, many Americans, Europeans, and others there who were madly in love with Fidel Castro. He's very amusing. When he wants to charm you, he can really charm you.
He was a populist. He mixed with the people. Fidel Castro would go to a hen farm and throw his arm around a woman and say, sister, how are those chicks coming along? For all his arrogance, he has a special touch with people.
Women loved Fidel. Women were just crazy about him, and after the revolution particularly, they just swarmed all over him. Fidel never wanted any information about his ladies, his women in his life, because with any charismatic leader, that dilutes the effectiveness. He has to remain mythical, he has to remain distant.
Fidel's alleged affairs became the talk of Havana, and one affair in particular with a mystery woman, the woman from the city of Trinidad.
He meets Dalia in 1961 in the literacy campaign. He fell pretty hard for her and took her places. In 64, 65. And he's been living with her ever since. He married her in 1980.
It would be years before the world learned that Fidel had a wife, Dalia Soto del Valle, five children, and even grandchildren. In an effort to patch up relations, Khrushchev invited Castro to visit the Soviet Union in April of 1963.
Fidel brought the old guard, the Soviet leadership, back to their own youth. the days when they were struggling as revolutionaries. It had a remarkable effect on Soviet spirits.
Castro reveled in his popularity and enjoyed privileges normally reserved for the Soviet elite. He even indulged in a bit of daydreaming. During a hunting trip at Khrushchev's country dacha, he could not help himself from wondering what would happen if he accidentally shot the Soviet premier.
The terms of the Soviet-Cuban military and civilian relationship was pretty much blueprinted on that trip. From that point forward, the Cubans never paid a penny for any military hardware. They asked, and then they received, more or less. The other part was that the Soviets would buy sugar at inflated prices, they would sell oil at deflated prices, and this would be paradise.
In 1966, before an audience of Third World revolutionaries, Fidel Castro reiterated his most unwavering commitment.
Así entendemos los revolucionarios cubanos nuestro deber internacionalista. Así entiende nuestro pueblo sus deberes, porque entiende que el enemigo es uno, el mismo que nos ataca a nosotros en nuestras costas y en nuestras tierras, el mismo que ataca a los demás. Y por eso decimos y proclamamos que con combatientes cubanos podrá contar el movimiento revolucionario en cualquier rincón de la tierra.
Fidel was engaged in this worldwide movement to really overthrow governments from Zanzibar to Salvador to Nicaragua, all over Central Africa. He helped in Vietnam, in Libya, in Algeria, in Syria. They had training camps for guerrillas all over Cuba and different parts of the world. I don't think anyone has any idea of what a big thing Fidel's adventures and ambitions led him to in the 1960s and even into the 70s.
While Castro built a world revolutionary movement, Che Guevara became its most visible advocate.
Que han decidido empezar a escribir ellos mismos para siempre su historia, porque esta gran humanidad.
Eloquent and idealistic, the dashing Guevara had acquired a reputation and a following second only to Fidel's.
There was simply not enough space by the mid-60s for both the gigantic personalities of Fidel Castro and Ernesto Che Guevara in Cuba. And the one that was going to leave was Che.
Fidel's relationship with Che is the same as with anyone else. You're useful to him one day and not the next. Che tells Fidel he's in Cuba only to train to go to other countries. And Fidel tells him, if that's what you want.
Disguised as a businessman, Che Guevara arrived in the Bolivian Andes in November 1966. He and a small band of Cubans hoped to ignite a continental revolution, which would transform the Andean mountains into the Sierra Maestra.
The American nation cannot, must not.
By then, President Lyndon Johnson was determined to stop the spread of communism.
Of another communist government in the Western Hemisphere.
And the Soviet leadership, who had never fully supported Castro's revolutionary adventures, decided to put an end to them.
Khrushchev is gone in October of 64. Leonid Brezhnev takes over. His number one priority is arms control negotiations with the United States. And these damn little Cubans are really ruining everything because the Americans say we can't start arms control until you Soviets bring these guys under control. This was the ultimatum. that Brezhnev gave Castro in roughly April of 67. We're not exactly sure of the date. This is in a letter to Castro. If they didn't rein in their revolutionary activities, Brezhnev would give the green light to Lyndon Johnson to go into Cuba.
Bolivia, July 1967, Che wrote in his diary. The negative aspects prevail, including the failure to make contact with the outside. We are down to 22 men, three of whom are disabled, including myself. For months, Che complained of being betrayed by Bolivia's Soviet-run Communist Party and of having no contact with Havana.
The interesting thing about Che in Bolivia was that he was in the eastern high Andes, which are readily accessible for anyone who knew where he was. Fidel knew where he was, but he'd cut off all radio contact with Che in Bolivia. And I went there, went in his footsteps, talked to his guerrilla group. He could have sent someone up from Paraguay. He could have sent someone out from La Paz, the capital. There was no contact. Che is left wandering around this very wild, high jungle.
On October 8th, hungry, sick, cut off from the outside world, Che Guevara and his handful of guerrillas were surrounded by the Bolivian Rangers, an elite army unit trained in counterinsurgency by the United States. Che was taken prisoner. The next day, he was executed. In death, Che Guevara would become an icon of revolution. As the prospects of world revolution dimmed, Fidel Castro turned his energies back toward transforming Cuban society. He set out to build communism in record time, faster than the Soviet Union, even China. Fidel would even try to mold a new man, selfless, dedicated, uncorruptible. There were some very real achievements. Children in Cuba did not go hungry. The sons and daughters of peasants and workers received a free education, one day becoming the engineers and doctors of revolutionary Cuba. Hospitals and clinics were built in the farthest reaches of the island, the foundation of a system that would eventually deliver health care to all Cubans. Prostitution and gambling virtually disappeared. But Cuba's socialist economy bordered on disaster. The U.S. embargo, the flight of managers and technicians to the United States, and economic mismanagement had left factories idle, store shelves empty, basic goods strictly rationed. La cola, the waiting line to purchase whatever was available, became the staple of daily life. Cubans called Fidel El Señor Habrá, Mr. There Will Be, and joked that if Spanish lacked a future tense, Castro would be rendered speechless. But Cubans could do little more than trade jokes. In Castro's Cuba, criticism was not permitted. There were no newspapers, except official ones, no books, except those sanctioned by the regime. Artists, hippies, homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses were labeled antisocial, rounded up, and sent to labor camps. Jails filled with prisoners, from those who simply spoke out against the regime to those who committed acts of violence.
Fighting the mountain, they think that I killed people.
Was that true?
I don't know. I don't believe it. I was judge in the tribunal.
Did you have a fair trial?
No.
There were thousands of political prisoners. Castro himself, in the mid-1960s, admitted to 20,000, which is already a staggering number. Already makes Cuba one of the highest, if not the highest, for per capita political imprisonment in Latin America's 20th century. The figure was probably closer to 40 or maybe even 50,000.
In March 1968, Castro moved to eliminate the last vestiges of capitalism in Cuba. He decreed all private businesses illegal. Street vendors, neighborhood cafes, shoe repair shops. Fixing a toaster in Cuba, one visiting economist remarked, has now become a matter of state.
He traveled in the 1960s constantly around the island, checking up on local managers and administrators and trying to solve problems himself, firsthand. He didn't delegate authority all that well. And the result, of course, is that Fidel could not be everywhere. And so consequently, when he wasn't there to make a decision, the decision didn't get made because no one else felt they had the authority to make the decision.
Fidel Castro is an enormously self-confident man, and he understands who he is, what he wants to do, where he wants to go, and he believes that he can do it. He fails to understand that there are many things he does not know, that there are a great many instances where people do not support him and he will not be able to accomplish his goals.
Fidel undertook one scheme after another, draining the Zapata swamp, planting a circle of dwarf coffee trees around Havana, creating a new breed of cattle.
Cuba was going to produce more cheese than Switzerland, more meat than France, more milk. So many things that I think that man believed them, because Fidel Castro believes his own words, and that's the most dangerous thing.
As one project faltered, Castro moved on to the next, always looking for the silver bullet. Finally, he turned to sugar, Cuba's traditional crop, and staked his reputation on producing 10 million tons in 1970.
Y que aquí se ha dicho que ni una libra menos de los 10 millones. Es el problema. Y hay que repetirlo y ratificarlo. Y sería una vergüenza increíble que nosotros nos fuéramos a quedar por debajo de los 10 millones.
The idea was, in effect, to double the size of the country's sugar harvest. And it meant turning Cuba upside down.
Everyone was mobilized. Factory workers, students, housewives. Volunteers came from all over the world. Vietnam, North Korea, the United States. But no matter how hard Fidel swung his machete, or how often he called on others to give their best, Cubans could not turn his dream into reality.
Instead of 10 million, 8.5 million metric tons of sugar were produced in 1970. It was, nonetheless, the largest sugar harvest in Cuban history. But it was a failure because the goal was not achieved, and because Cuban resources were destroyed, and because the country, instead of free, powerful, and independent, was in a state of virtual collapse.
no voy a andar con rodeos para decirlo. Creo que para mí, igual que para cualquier otro cubano, y un grado muy alto, significa realmente algo muy duro. Significa algo muy duro, tal vez más duro que ninguna otra experiencia en la lucha revolucionaria.
The Soviet Union stepped in. Fidel would no longer be allowed to run the economy from his jeep. A powerful council of ministers would make all major decisions in concert with the Soviet bloc. 10,000 Soviet advisors would lend a hand.
Castro presided over the revolution's essential capitulation to Soviet demands, organizational demands, structural demands, foreign policy demands, and perhaps one of the hardest things for Castro to accept was that he agreed to stop criticizing the Soviet Union in any fashion, direct or veiled criticism.
Delighted, Moscow rewarded Cuba with subsidies of up to $6 billion per year.
The economy began to recover through about 1976, 1977. People had a real feeling of hope that the sacrifices of the 1960s were paying off economically.
We see no virtue in perpetual antagonism between the United States and Cuba. Our concern relates above all Cuba's export of revolution.
On March 1st, 1975, U.S. Secretary of State Henry Kissinger made a surprising announcement.
We have taken some symbolic steps to indicate that we are prepared to move in a new direction if Cuba will.
It was the era of U.S.-Soviet détente, and President Gerald Ford moved to normalize relations with Cuba and to end the 15-year-old U.S. economic embargo.
What would you like Americans to know about you and Cuba? And could you possibly say it in English so they could understand?
In English. I am not well in English.
Well, could then in Spanish.
Good wish for the people of the United States.
Good wishes.
Wish of understanding. Wish of friendship. I understand it is not easy because we belong to two different words, but we are vecinos, ¿cómo se dice?
Neighbors.
We are neighbors, and in one way or another, we ought to be to live in peace, United States and Cuba.
That fall, the State Department announced Cuba and the United States were ready to begin an official dialogue. But all along, Fidel Castro had had his eye on a situation developing half a world away, preparing Cuba for its first large-scale war. In West Africa, the Portuguese colony of Angola, about to become independent, was fast sliding into civil war. The Marxist Movement for the Liberation of Angola, the MPLA, asked Castro for military assistance to fight against its rivals, backed by South Africa. Fidel Castro faced a tough choice: intervention in Angola or rapprochement with the United States. On November 7th, 3 days before Independence Day, Cuban troops arrived in force. The U.S. government was caught by surprise.
The rapprochement, or normalization, with the United States was derailed. He placed a higher priority on his internationalist revolutionary objectives than on better relations with the United States.
¿Qué clase de condiciones pretende el imperialismo establecer a nuestro país? ejercemos nuestra solidaridad con Angola, estamos ayudando a Angola y seguiremos ayudando al pueblo de Angola.
By January 1976, there were 15,000 Cuban troops in Angola. Armed and supplied by the Soviet Union, they pushed back the Army of South Africa and secured the MPLA in power.
The Cuban intervention in Angola identifies Cuba as a country that's willing to take a risk, willing to put its own interests on the line, willing to provoke a confrontation with the United States in support of national liberation in Africa. It boosts Cuba's prestige in the Third World enormously.
Castro assumed the role of leader of a major power. His doctors and teachers were serving as far away as Yemen. His troops were fighting in Angola and Ethiopia, in close alliance with the Soviet Union. Soon he would play a key role in another war. The Sandinista insurrection against Anastasio Somoza in Nicaragua.
The Sandinista victory in Nicaragua was directed by Fidel Castro from the headquarters of Cuba's special forces. They had broken the codes of the Somoza army, and Fidel knew all their movements and told the Sandinistas where to lay ambushes, what to do until they took power. That was a war directed by Fidel Castro.
It was Castro's first victory in the Western Hemisphere, one he'd been waiting for since 1959.
Los revolucionarios no podemos ser pesimistas. Los revolucionarios somos y seremos siempre optimistas. Tampoco nos dejaremos intimidar. Nuestros pueblos han demostrado a la larga de la historia su capacidad de lucha.
Él se ve en ese momento como la punta de lanza.
He sees himself as the spearhead of a great socialist revolution.
Que en el plazo de 10 años todo el Caribe.
And believes that in 10 years all the Caribbean is going to be dominated by Cuba. And he is going to play the key role, be the other great power.
La otra gran
and he sees himself as a figure of that
se
stature.
Así, como una figura de ese tamaño y de esa naturaleza.
In September 1979, Fidel Castro was elected leader of the Movement of Non-Aligned Nations. 1 month later, he traveled to New York to address the United Nations.
Siempre está protegido con su traje.
¿Cuál traje?
What suit.
Everybody says you always have
a que todo el mundo vest. Dice que usted tiene un chaleco a prueba de balas.
No. Voy a desembarcar así en Nueva York.
I will land in New York like this.
Tengo un chaleco.
I will land in New York like this.
Tengo un chaleco moral.
I have a moral one.
A moral vest.
It's strong.
Those months of the fall of 1979 really were the apogee of his triumphs. Here he was, the duly chosen, selected president of the non-aligned countries, the Asian, African, Middle Eastern, and Latin American countries. How can you be a loyal, dependable Soviet ally and at the same time be the leader of the non-aligned nations? Well, Castro was able to carry out that exquisite, seemingly impossible balancing act until the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan.
Here you had the Soviet Union occupying a non-aligned country. Cuba was caught then between its constituency among the non-aligned and its partnership with the Soviet Union, and it refused to denounce the invasion of Afghanistan and lost extraordinary credibility with the rest of the non-aligned countries.
The following spring, Castro faced an unexpected crisis when an incident at an embassy in Havana spiraled out of control.
This bus of Cubans seeking asylum in the Peruvian embassy crashes through the gates. The two guards on each side are firing at the bus, but as the bus goes through, they shoot each other. And so Castro takes a position, we're not going to risk the lives of our policemen, keep people out of embassies when we don't care if they go in. So they remove the guards. Bad mistake, because within 3 days you had 10,000 people inside the Peruvian embassy and more headed there from all over the island.
He was totally preoccupied with international affairs in the fall and winter of 1979. I'm convinced that he was not aware of the depth of unrest on the island, unrest that was steadily growing below the surface.
Castro was enraged. He branded the refugees escoria, trash. Anyone who wanted to leave Cuba, he announced, was free to go.
No los queremos, no los necesitamos.
Cubans who so publicly turned their backs on Castro's revolution were subjected to every humiliation, harassment, even beatings, in full view of the newly opened U.S. interest section in Havana.
They were brought here in trucks and buses. This was stimulated by the government, and the foreign minister will not answer the phone.
In Miami, the Cuban exiled community organized a massive sea lift, which received the blessing of President Jimmy Carter.
We are the most generous nation on earth in receiving the refugees seeking freedom from communist domination and from economic deprivation brought about primarily by Fidel Castro and his government.
The flotilla anchored at the port of Mariel, where tens of thousands were waiting.
We're taking whatever people, they give us. So we got crazy people, we got prisoners, they say political prisoners, we got some criminals. Who knows what kind of people we got here?
Castro, one senior U.S. official remarked, is using people like bullets aimed at this country.
Castro wanted to inflict the greatest possible pain on the United States. And he wanted perhaps to contaminate, in a sense, the Cuban exile community. Because at that time, the Cuban exile community was beginning to acquire considerable political influence in the American political process.
By September, 125,000 refugees had arrived in Miami. Overwhelmed by the influx, Jimmy Carter put an end to the boat lift.
Mariel was a shame because it was not just Cuba's upper class that emigrated, but ordinary factory workers emigrated. Some of Cuba's leading intellectuals. Many young people who had grown up under the revolution emigrated as well. But Mariel was also a shame because the regime showed its ugly side to the international community when it deported common criminals to the United States, committing an act of aggression, not just against the imperialist U.S. government, but against the American people.
Mariel had not yet faded from memory when Fidel Castro faced a new challenge.
As for the enemies of freedom,
President Ronald Reagan came to office determined to wage war on communism, beginning close to home. Reagan authorized the CIA to train an army, the Contras, to wage war against Castro's Sandinista allies in Nicaragua. He sent American troops to invade the island of Grenada, a Cuban ally, where for the first time, Castro's men faced American soldiers. And set out to expose Castro's human rights record, building on the testimony of political prisoners recently released from Cuban jails.
I have the sad memory that three of my cellmates were murdered in prison. The first was Roberto López Chávez. He was 16 years old when he was first imprisoned. Another was Pedro Luis Boitel, a student leader Castro hated with all his heart. Boitel went on a hunger strike, and Fidel Castro ordered that his cell door not be opened until he died of thirst. He died of thirst 53 days later. Like these, hundreds of stories of assassinations and torture.
Those prisons were killing machines. People were not only deprived of their liberty. What the government wanted was to eliminate all counter-revolutionaries. La Cabaña, Isla de Pinos, all those stories. Words cannot express all the suffering and anguish because words pale against the reality behind them.
In March 1987, the U.S. delegation in Geneva requested that the U.N. Human Rights Commission condemn Cuba for massive, systematic, and flagrant abuses of human rights. The next year, under pressure, Castro invited the commission to Cuba to investigate. From Havana, Ricardo Bofill encouraged witnesses to come forward.
Ricardo Bofill ni nos preocupa. Yo no tengo elementos de juicio para saber lo que hará, lo que no hará. No tengo noticia de cuál es su actitud. Pero eso no tiene importancia ni una clase. Esos son fuegos artificiales ante la realidad de la historia. No nos preocupa.
Bueno, la comisión llegó a La Habana y abrió.
The commission met at the Commodore Hotel in Havana. Dozens of people came, the relatives of people who had been executed, including those murdered in the Escambray, people who had been tortured, prisoners unjustly jailed, in short, witnesses to violations of practically all 30 articles of the Declaration of Human Rights.
The commission's findings were documented in a 400-page report and presented in Geneva.
It is at that moment when even activists from the political left, when left-wing democratic politicians begin to say to the Cuban government, your violation of the human rights of ordinary Cubans is wrong and unacceptable even by the standards of the international left, that the Cuban government finds itself cornered, humiliated, and for the first time understands that it is losing allies everywhere.
Soviet Premier Mikhail Gorbachev paid an overdue visit to Fidel Castro's Cuba in April 1989. For 4 years now, Gorbachev had pushed economic and political reform in the Soviet Union. And expectations in Cuba had been running high.
There was almost euphoria that Cuba would follow the steps, which they had been doing for several decades, of the Soviet Union in opening up. And the people I was talking to in the Cuban Communist Party were very, very enthusiastic that Cuba would open up just as the Soviet Union had opened up.
But by the time of Gorbachev's visit, those who expected Fidel to embrace perestroika and glasnost were bitterly disappointed. Openness and reform are dangerous Fidel had declared in July 1988, and represent a threat to fundamental socialist principles.
Fidel Castro believes the United States is going to have an economic crisis and is going to collapse, and that everyone will see he is the one who is right, and that Cuba is going to remain a breeding ground of revolution. That is, Cuba is going to be the Jurassic Park of communism.
But it was the Soviet Union that collapsed in 1991.
From the first time Fidel Castro appears on Cuba's national stage, July 26, 1953, he has been convinced that history is on his side. And he believes so for the decades that followed, until the Soviet Union collapses. All of a sudden, he knew that his world had come to an end.
The collapse of the Soviet Union was a blow. He aged at that moment. In fact, he said, "We never thought the sun would stop shining, and it did."
Y que tengamos siempre una patria digna, una patria independiente, y no una colonia yanqui. Hay que salvar la patria. Hay que salvar la revolución. Hay que salvar el socialismo. Socialismo muerte.
Fidel was telling Cubans to preserve the revolution and to preserve socialism. They had to tighten their belts and replace cars with oxen and go back to the Stone Ages and live in caves if necessary. He said that, actually. I'm not making this up. So the stuff you saw, like, on the streets and everywhere, amazing, crazy.
Between the spring of 1992 and the spring of 1994, we were stunned at what had happened. Everybody was in such terrible shape that it was hard to believe they could pull themselves out of what they called this special period. It looked as if the Cuban Revolution, the regime of Fidel Castro, was finished.
In Miami, the exiled community waited for Fidel to fall and lobbied Washington to tighten the embargo. But Castro refused to give in. He exported discontent by making it legal for anyone to leave Cuba, unleashing a new exodus. In a stunning reversal, Castro opened Cuba to foreign investors and foreign tourists, and allowed U.S. dollars to circulate freely. The economy improved, but prostitution, corruption, and speculation flourished.
There was a great chasm between the promise of the revolution and its results. Fidel was always a man of promises. He wooed the people with promises. The end result was a dictatorship, pure and simple. Each day more stripped of the attributes that once made it attractive.
For more than four decades, Fidel Castro has ruled Cuba, inspiring many with visions of a brilliant future and silencing those who dared to oppose him. Striding across the world stage in a role never intended for the leader of a small island, in the shadow of the United States.
He has managed to remain in power longer than almost any other leader in the last 100 or 200 years.
Ahora comprendo
que mi destino no era venir al mundo para descansar al final de la vida.
It's a remarkable tenure, and it's testament to his political skills, to his ability to manage crises, to anticipate crises, to play as a grandmaster at chess, to play two and three moves ahead.
Castro plays David to our Goliath masterfully. Wherever Castro goes, he is applauded, not because people want to adopt the Cuban system, no, because he has defied the United States and survived.
Como cubano,
as a Cuban, I wish more could be salvaged, because it would make it easier to rebuild Cuba. Cuba was a nation with a history, a culture, and an economy that needed reform, but not the madness of more than four decades.
For Cuba, January 1959 was a time of glory, a time when all things seemed possible, when an entire nation placed its hopes in just one man.
There's more about Castro and Cuba at American Experience Online. See a timeline of Cuban history. Find out more about Cuba's future and share your own views. All this and more at pbs.org.